Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here today. And thank you, Governor Villard de Gallo, for convening this eminent group of people to celebrate our birthday, the 75th anniversary of the Bretton Woods institutions. It's great to be among so many supporters of the IMF. 75 years ago, the founders met at the Hotel Washington in Bretton Woods. I'm going to show you a photo that was, and this is not a joke, that was taken there 1 week ago. Literally. Now, I guess at least we can take comfort in the fact that the bears are on vacation. Now, Christine Lagarde was looking forward to addressing you today. Once again, the IMF is in transition. But fortunately, we're accustomed to that. We do it well, and we will try to do the best we can in this transition. The key theme of my remarks today is exactly that, that the IMF is an institution that was built to adapt to change. And don't worry, in Christine's honor, I'll be sure to quote from one or two historical figures. I'm especially pleased that our great former IMF managing directors, De La Rosière and Cam de Sue, have been here today. As was just mentioned, I served under both of those men early in my career and admire them tremendously. We've also had Ann Krieger, one of my predecessors, here today. It's great to have them all. These are people who know quite a bit about change at the IMF. Despite our 75 years of history, the Bretton Woods institutions have aged gracefully. Our collaboration is stronger than ever. I'd like to thank David Malpass for continuing this excellent relationship that we have between the fund and the bank. And speaking of famous partnerships, those of you who've seen the most recent edition of the IMF's Finance and Development Quarterly may have noticed we have a conversation between Madame Lagarde and John Maynard Keynes. In this imagined conversation, Lord Keynes and Madame Lagarde enjoy a chat about the IMF. He was glad to find that the fund had successfully adapted to so many challenges over the years, and most of all, that our commitment to pursuing economic and financial stability in a multilateral and rules-based setting had held firm. What if we had a time machine, perhaps borrowed from Keynes's friend H.G. Wells, and we could leap forward 25 years, 50, or even 75 years ahead from the present? What would the world and what would the IMF look like? I would hope that Lord Keynes could at least recognize us, busy still promoting growth and financial stability, adapting to the needs of our members. That forward journey is what I would like to talk about today. But first, let me briefly consider the past. The architects of the Bretton Woods institutions were deeply influenced by the events between the two world wars, when multilateralism and the liberal international order broke down amidst protectionism, the malfunction of the gold standard, and competitive devaluations. The implosion of world trade then deepened the Great Depression and ultimately gave fuel to fascism, communism, and war. But in the aftermath, lessons were learned. There was a newfound appreciation of how much national and global economic interests are truly interconnected. The founders at Bretton Woods resolved that economic development and financial stability are necessary conditions for peace. In the recent words of Queen Elizabeth II, they built an assembly of international institutions to ensure that the horrors of conflict would never be repeated. This was the Bretton Woods moment was our original multilateral moment. And we know the results. Tremendous gains in human well-being, life expectancy, educational attainment, child and maternal mortality. Global GDP per capita is 5 times higher than in 1945. And as Francois mentioned this morning, over 1 billion people have broken free of poverty. And billions more are reaping the mutual benefits generated by trade. I've been proud to spend much of my career at the institution that's at the center of this story. Now, over the years, there's never been a Bretton Woods II, even though there have been many calls for that. Yet we are a very different institution than at our founders' time. So how did that happen? It's because we continuously adapt to the changing circumstances around us. I think Lord Keynes would have been pleased to see the IMF pivot once our members abandoned the Bretton Woods system and switched to a system of flexible exchange rates, even though he may have agreed with Jacques Delarosière that it was a bad idea in the first place. I think he would have been pleased at how we addressed the Latin American debt crisis, starting during the tenure of Jacques Delarosière. Then how we helped to transition economies from communism and enabled many of those countries finally to join the IMF. And how we've addressed what Michel Camdessou dubbed the 21st century crises, those that arose from the explosion of cross-border flows. As we look to the next 75 years, the IMF will have to continue to adapt. I think that's actually underway. Let's consider what we may face in the coming decades. First, how shifting economic and financial power will affect the role of the fund. Second, how technological change will transform economies, creating new opportunities, policy challenges, including challenges coming from technological change in financial services. And third, how threats to multilateralism will arise and test whether the Bretton Woods institutions remain relevant. Let me talk about those three. So let me first turn to the ongoing shifts in the global economic landscape. Since those 44 country delegations met at Bretton Woods, the IMF has grown, and now we have 189 members, almost the entire world economy. That means that while we can address issues on a global scale, the roles and interests of our membership are also changing. The rise of China and other economies fundamentally alters the global landscape, as many have talked about already today. As emerging market and developing economies grow and incomes converge, the share of advanced economies in global output is expected to fall from more than a half to about a third over the next 25 years. Aging populations in advanced economies will gradually consume savings, even as younger countries need to finance investments. And in the not too distant future, rising life expectancy and declining fertility rates will likely bring issues of aging to everyone else as well, to the entire world. This will have profound implications for global trade and capital flows. The hubs of economic activity will shift over the coming decades. New financial centers will grow in importance. New reserve currencies may well emerge. Throughout all of that, it's our duty to maintain an international monetary system stable and robust enough to facilitate economic adjustments accompanying these transitions. Free trade, flexible exchange rates, and non-disruptive capital flow movements are essential ingredients for a thriving global economy. That's why the role of multilateral institutions, including especially even the IMF, is likely to be more relevant than ever if we continue to adapt. Fortunately, our founders had the wisdom to embed in our governance the quota-based system. And I want to say a few words about this because I think it's quite important. They recognized the illusory logic of one country, one vote for an organization like ours. Over our history and on into the future, this approach allows governance to adjust to the rising prominence, interests, and responsibilities of our fast-growing members. Many international organizations don't have this built-in flexibility, and they find that some members feel they don't have the influence that they deserve. Yet the fund's governance really needs to evolve further. For that to happen, we must remain a quota-based institution, and we must reckon with the fact that our formulae have not really fully kept pace. We can't expect to retain global reach and resources and legitimacy that we need unless countries gaining in economic importance and ready to take on commensurate responsibility, gain appropriately in the say they have at the IMF. Similarly, we have to continue to align our policies and our tools with these changing economic realities. The inclusion of the renminbi in the SDR was one example of a step in that direction. It demonstrated our ability to change. The bottom line is this: as economic power becomes more diverse and more diffuse, retaining a focus on common challenges is likely to be more difficult. So the IMF's fundamental role as global convener, trusted advisor, and financial firefighter will become even more important than it's been. What about other changes in the global economy? Technological advances offer enormous opportunities to accelerate productivity and to lift incomes. But they also lead to structural changes, creating some jobs while displacing others. Lord Keynes himself warned back in the 1930s about the possibility of what he called technological unemployment. He actually believed it would lead to a high-income world where people would choose more leisure as time went on, more leisure over work as they became wealthier. This turned out differently. People are actually anxious that constant technological advances, think about artificial intelligence, will threaten their jobs and their incomes. I'll come to the future of work in a minute. But let me first address a different dimension of technological change: innovation in financial services. What we call fintech offers the potential to significantly increase efficiency and transparency in the financial sector. It poses challenges for established players and regulators who are trying to deal with sources of risk. There are some very real downsides to financial services technological change, including threats from cyber attacks and cyber criminals. Yet I think we're on the cusp of a substantial transformation that could bring enormous benefits. By fostering competition, we can help reorient the financial services industry closer to, better serve the real economy and to foster job creation. Look at fintech's capacity to end financial exclusion for the 1.7 billion people in developing countries who have no access to banking. Much has been said already about the impact of fintech on mobile banking in Africa, a continent that needs to create 20 million jobs a year in decades to come just to deal with its population growth. That's why, together with the World Bank, we developed the Bali FinTech Agenda, which was a framework to help our members take advantage of innovation, but also cope with the new risks that come with that. One aspect of relevance today is the nascent development of central bank digital currencies and the possible emergence of privately backed stablecoins for digital payments. This was highlighted in the recent attention that's been drawn to Facebook's and others' proposals for what they call the Libra coin. These new instruments aim to do for transactions what the internet has done for information, which is to make transactions instantaneous, secure, and nearly free. Yesterday, we published a new paper that highlights the benefits, risks, and regulatory issues that are likely to emerge in the years ahead, and others, the BIS, and a number of central banks are working on this issue as well. The benefits are clear: ease of use, lower costs, and global reach. But what about the risks? We've identified several: the potential emergence of new monopolies with implications for how personal data is monetized, the impact on weaker currencies of a new form of dollar akin to dollarization, a form of substitution into coins, the opportunities for illicit activities, threats to financial stability, and the challenge of corporations issuing and thus earning large sums of what's essentially seniorage as they issue these coins, of course, which has been exclusively the realm of central banks. So regulators and the IMF will need to step in. We need to create an environment where the benefits of technology can be reaped while the risks are minimized. This is what I mean when I talk about an IMF always adapting. When a challenge affects our members' economic well-being, we have to be ready to serve. While we adapt to technological transformations, we can't lose sight of other pressing concerns. Our world is experiencing quite a broad range of new challenges that are contributing to a breakdown of trust and social cohesion, especially in advanced economies. Trade and globalization, along with technology, have reshaped the economic map. And the fallout, of course, is as front and center here in Europe, as well as in the United States. We see rising anger, political polarization, and populism. I think we're at risk of what you might call a reverse Bretton Woods moment. Part of the problem, of course, is the rise in excessive inequality. Capitalism, of course, will always have inequality. But this has become a national challenge in many countries and really a global challenge. Although poverty rates have declined worldwide, the top one-tenth of the top 1% worldwide has garnered roughly the same economic benefits that have accrued to the bottom 50% since 1980. Moreover, for many developing countries, convergence of living standards towards the high-income countries has stalled. Just 4 years ago, we estimated it would take about a half a century for low-income countries to reach advanced economy living standards of today. If global integration falters, that could take much longer. Some see an inherent flaw in capitalism. I guess I don't agree. Capitalism rewards risk-taking, so we need risk-taking, and we need capitalism. It has been the engine of growth behind so much of the success that we've seen, but it is imperfect, so maybe what we ought to think about is course correction. We must prove that the benefits of globalization and of open and integrated markets outweigh the costs, and that integration can help address our shared challenges. But right now, in many areas, I think we're losing the argument. So we need a roadmap. The question is, where do we start? Let me go through a few items. First, we can use fiscal policy to try to address inequality. This has been part of the economic toolkit for many years, but the fund has developed a new framework to look at social spending and help member countries in the years to come. While we help countries raise revenues needed for future spending, it's also essential to ensure fairness and a level playing field. That means in the realm of global corporate taxation, we need to close loopholes, forestall profit shifting, and avoid a race to the bottom. And a related point that I've already alluded to, we need to fight against illicit financial flows and money laundering, because corruption undermines trust in all facets of society. Another important priority is modernizing the international trade system, including in services and e-commerce. This will help reduce the trade tensions that threaten to undermine global growth. The leaders have called for this, but there isn't really much progress yet, and it really makes sense to make this a priority agenda item. When it comes to global growth, every country should empower women. Back at Bretton Woods, the role of women was limited to secretarial support. But much has changed since then, thank goodness. But about 90% of countries who are our members still have legal barriers to female economic participation, legal barriers. Realizing the massive potential of women is an economic no-brainer, something Christine Lagarde has said time and time again. This should be a priority. And last but certainly not least, we have to accelerate our work on climate change. Climate change presents one of the greatest challenges of the century, as was recognized here in this city in 2015. The economic consequences, if we don't act, will be dire. That's why we at the Fund are increasingly engaging our membership on mitigating and adapting to climate change and advising on energy subsidies, on carbon pricing. We're also trying to help our members enhance their resilience to natural disasters, some of which stem from climate change. Now, Lord Keynes might be surprised at some of what I've said and some of what's happening, but I think he'd probably be pleased that the fund is still a forward-looking, problem-solving institution. In finishing up, let me, as I promised, follow Madame Lagarde's lead. So in honor of our host, let me borrow from Alexandre Dumas, who wrote, "All human wisdom is contained in two words, wait and hope." If you will allow me a suggestion for this Bretton Woods moment, hope yes, but this is not a time to wait. In the years ahead, we must all act and act together, staying true to the values of our founders while pursuing the goals of stability, prosperity, and peace. Thank you very much.
Thanks, David. So maybe we have time for one or two questions, please. Yeah, Richard.
Yep. David, you referred to the new fund paper on stablecoins. I'd seen an account of the paper brief in the FT, I guess, this morning. What role do you see, potential role do you see for regulation? Does the study see for regulators in dealing with this phenomenon? How are you going to control, how could we control the extraction of seniorage? How could we stop or limit currency substitution and so on? What could the regulators do in practice?
I think there are a set of different challenges, and the answers map to those challenges. I think there will be, first and foremost, issues about the economics of a network. If this particular proposal is as a first mover becomes a huge network, you'll have similar kinds of competition and trust issues that you have with the big networks today, whether they control access to their network and whether there are abnormal profits there. Much has been written by others about the question of the use, the monetization of everyone's information, all of the transactions that they would see. I think it comes down to data privacy laws and competition policy. If the stablecoin were to become the basis for banking, as has happened or seems to be happening in China with Tencent and Alipay, if there's leverage, credit extension, and so on, they'll have to be regulated like banks. On seniorage, I think the issue is whether there can be, through the competition policy, enough competition that you don't have just one stable coin, but you have several, and they compete for people to use their coin and perhaps offer interest in a competitive way. And I think there are things that can be done to potentially connect these coins to central bank digital currencies. I think the harder problems to deal with are if these coins involve cross-border flows and are huge in volume, to monitor the nature of the transactions for illicit activities, I think, is very tricky. And Secretary Mnuchin has been expressing on behalf of the United States concern about that, and I think that's very real. But when you put it this way, it sounds as though there are so many risks that perhaps it ought to be squelched, and I think some will say that. We put it the way we've put it because we look back at the history of technology and innovation, and I think a conclusion is that you never know at the beginning how valuable a technology will be. It requires experimentation and adaptation, often over years, even decades, to find out how valuable it would be. And it doesn't make sense, I think, to start with the approach that there should be no use of this technology. Rather, it makes sense to figure out a way in which there can be an environment where experimentation can go forward, but the risks are, there are ways to protect against the risks. We know that even in the proposals that are out there, that there's potential for cost reduction and for speed. I mean, just looking at Alipay. Alipay, Jack Ma explains that Visa and MasterCard can transfer money from you, Richard, to someone else in 3 days for 2%. And he can do it in a nanosecond for 0.1%. And the fact that this can be done for people who are nowhere near a bank, and much of our membership is in that situation, means that we shouldn't just turn our backs on the opportunity side of this. I feel strongly about this. Rather, we need to find a way to see if something really good can be made of it, but protect against the risk. Sorry for the long answer.
Maybe just two questions. Be concise and introduce yourself in the middle. Yeah, here. Yeah, you have the mic in the armchair.
Yes, you referred to the conversation that Keynes would have today with Mrs. Lagarde. We remember that Keynes wanted a world currency, the banker. The name of it would be today the special drawing right, waiting for a better name. So my question is, what role do you see for the SDR in the international monetary system of the future? And what steps does the IMF take to enhance its role as a stable reserve currency, as an instrument for an effective management of global liquidity, and more generally, as a lever to move to a more balanced and equitable international monetary system? You will understand my question when you know that I'm the chairman of the International Robert Triffin Association, and a former executive director of the World Bank. Thank you.
Thank you. We will take the last question at the same time. Yeah, please.
Thank you. I heard many times Christine Lagarde talk about climate change as a macro critical. And David, do you think that IMF has, for the moment, all the tools to respond to this massive transition that all countries have to walk through? And would you envisage other role for IMF to help, thinking the long term immediately?
We are, let me do them in reverse order. On climate change, I think we will find over time that there are really quite important roles for the IMF, but in certain areas. Climate change issues go well beyond our mandate. But we have a paper coming out in the fall as part of our fiscal monitor that will examine countries' commitments to the Paris Agreement, ask the question, with present policies, are they likely to achieve them? What policies would be required to achieve them? And lay out a whole menu of possible ways that countries can augment their efforts. I think this will, to me, there still seems to be a lot of confusion about the policy choices. I think we can also convene groups to deal with some of the, how to put it, paradoxes of climate change, that some of the poorer countries are, at this juncture in history, the greatest contributors, but have the least ability to take steps to reduce emissions. I think there are many things we can do. We also are looking at green finance and the role that finance can play. And we're looking at the range of issues that Mark Carney has spent time highlighting about how to think about the financial sector's vulnerabilities to climate change. So there will be, I think, some important contributions coming from us. To be fair, we have to boost our own capacity in this area. We didn't start out with a lot of experts on climate change, but we are acquiring expertise. On the SDR question, let me start where you did with Keynes. The SDR that we have is not Bancor. It never was. It is a very particular, in essence, arrangement enshrined in articles, not easy to change, with a very strict distribution scheme. It's not something that can be used to provide global liquidity. So we really need to, I think there are some legitimate questions about the role of the fund. I think it's a long way to go to consider anything that, like what Jacques de la Rosière ended with, which is, in essence, a global money and central bank. And to some extent, Keynes was pointing in that direction. But even if you start in a much more, in an area that's much closer to present needs, the question of what do you do for countries that have liquidity problems but do not have balance of payments problems or solvency issues? Say a country that basically manages its affairs pretty well, but because of the shifts in the global capital markets of the world, changes in risk appetites, finds that money that had washed in washes out, and they have, and it was a dollar exposure, and they have dollar needs. There's a small family of countries that have swap arrangements with the Fed who are more or less taken care of, but there is no liquidity, generally speaking, no liquidity provider for the bulk of our membership. One could try to address that question at the IMF. You wouldn't start by trying to amend the SDR rules. You'd start by saying, if we need to provide cross-border liquidity to deal with very large and quixotic capital flow movements, how would you deal with it? It wouldn't be by starting with the SDR. So I think you're right in pointing to the fact that there may be events and risks in the world that we are not equipped to deal with. Our general department allows us to have the resources to deal with balance of payments problems in a set of countries. It does not equip us financially to deal with some of the kinds of capital account crises or capital account events that could well happen in the modern world. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much, and we can.